lesson, Animal Kingdom Children. So before we get into the lesson, to understand this lesson, again, it is like to know the characteristics. This is this, this is this, this is this. Why this is this? Nature has created and organisms have evolved. So to make this as small and concise, we have put it in this PDF in the form of graphic organizers. Now let me explain to you, and here also I would like to show you some slides, because again, most of the diagrammatic questions are from this chapter. Now, depending upon the type of cellular organization, organisms, you know, they exhibit different kinds of levels of organization. One is cellular level of organization. Here, the cells are arranged as loose aggregates. Some division of labor will be seen among the animals. If your example would be porifera, tissue level of organization, you know, and group of cells organized together, they form a tissue, and this is the tissue level of organization. Organ level of organization is tissues are grouped to form the organs, and different organs take up different functions, as in platyhelminthes. And the next is organ level system of organization, where organs will associate into complex systems. For example, you have studied urine, or you all human beings exhibit organ system level of organization. So you know you have a digestive system, respiratory system, excretory system with so many organs in it, isn't it? So this is the organ system level of organization, which is seen in annelids, arthropods, mollusks, echinoderms, and chordates. Now let us look at the digestive system. See, in this now I'm going to give you a brief review of what are all the important terminologies you need to know. When I'm getting into the phylum, if I say this is complete, incomplete, or this is this, 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 then you shouldn't get baffled. What are these terms? You don't have to refer back. That is why I'm now giving you in the beginning itself the explanation for the terms that are used when we are describing the different phyla. Now, digestive system, if it has got both a mouth and an anus, it is said to be as complete digestive system. Now, if it is if it has only one opening which serves both as a mouth and an anus, then you call it as an incomplete digestive system. Circulatory system again will be of two types. One is the open type. Here, the blood is pumped out of the heart and cells and tissues are bathed in it. So, it is an open type of circulatory system. In closed type, the blood will flow through arteries, veins and capillaries, or through blood vessels. Now, based on the symmetry, you know, organisms are divided into asymmetrical organisms, so which cannot be divided into two halves in any plane. For example, if you take sponges, you take them in any plane, you will not be able to divide them into two halves. Now, radially symmetrical organisms. So, when any plane is passing through the central axis of the body, it will divide the organism into two identical halves. So, it is almost circular in nature. Coelenterates, stenophora and echinoderms are examples. So these examples, you please make a note of it, kids. This is very important, because they will mix and ask you to identify the organisms that show bilateral symmetry, or organisms that show asymmetry, or the organisms that will show radial symmetry. So you should know the organisms well. Now, bilaterally symmetrical organisms, animals whose body can be divided into right and left halves in only one plane, are called bilaterally symmetrical organisms.
Continue, ma'am. Hello.
Shall I go from the beginning? Okay, diploblastic and triploblastic organization. I'm repeating because you didn't see the screen, children. Sorry. Now, diploblastic organisms are the animals in which the cells are organized into two embryonic layers, an external ectoderm and an internal endoderm. So, ecto means outside, endo is inside. Please remember this word. So, the layer that is outside is the ectoderm, and the embryonic layer that is inside is known as the endoderm. In between ectoderm and endoderm, you find a glue-like substance, and this is called as mesoglia. Example, coelenterates. Triploblastic organisms, animals in which the developing embryo has a third germinal layer. In between ectoderm and endoderm, there is a middle layer, and this is called as the mesoderm. Now, this is important. Please make a note. Both look circular with only cells and cells, but they will ask you to identify which is diploblastic and which is triploblastic. So, make a note. Examples for triploblastic organisms are Platyhelminthes to chordates. The next one is cavity, that is the coelom. The cavity present between the body wall and the gut wall is known as the coelom. Based on this, organisms are classified into coelomates, pseudocoelomate, and acoelomate. So, if you look at coelomate, if the body cavity is lined by the mesoderm, then you call it as the coelomate animals. Example, annelids, mollusks, arthropods, echinoderms, hemichordates, and chordates. Pseudocoelomates means the body cavity is not lined by the mesoderm. Instead, the mesoderm will be present in pouches here and there. And such a coelom is called pseudocoelom, and organisms are called pseudocoelomates. Only example you have is the Ascalminthes. And next is the acoelomate. The animals in which the coelom is absent is called as the acoelomate, and that is Platyhelminthes is an example. Again, these all look cellular, but please understand these diagrams are very important. If you have something in the center, then this becomes the coelom. If this is occurring in pouches scattered like this, it is pseudocoelom. And nothing in the center, but everywhere only the cells, then it is acoelomate organism or it is an acoelom. Now, notochord, animals with notochord are called chordates. And animals without notochords are called non-chordates. Now, examples will be from Porifera to Echinodermata. Now, characteristic of different phyla. See here. This text has been really, this graphic organizer, what your NCERT textbook, it gives you a bird's eye view to understand about the different phyla. Now, if you look at kingdom Animalia, it is multicellular. So, here he has divided into cellular, tissue, organ, and organ system together. Okay, now cellular level, you have only one phylum, that is Porifera. Now a tissue, organ or organ system, you have all the rest of the phyla, but they are divided broadly based on the symmetry into radial and bilateral. So in the radial symmetry, you have Coelenterata, Ctenophora. Okay, Coelenterata and Ctenophora. In bilaterally symmetrical, here by all the coelom, that is eucoelomate, acoelomate and pseudocoelomate, are bilateral organisms. So please understand that radially symmetrical organisms do not have coelom, but bilaterally symmetrical organisms may have a pseudocoelom or a true coelom, or they can be without a coelom. So example, Platyhelminthes with false coelom, Ascalminthes. The true coelom, Annelida, Arthropoda, Mollusca, Echinodermata, Hemichordata, and Chordata. Now, if you look at it, Echinodermata exhibits radial or bilateral symmetry. In the larval stages, if you see, they exhibit bilateral symmetry, and in the adult forms, they will exhibit radial symmetry. So that they might ask you in the examination. Now, let us look at classification of let me get into the details about invertebrates. Here we have put it, instead of putting everything like that, which would be very cumbersome for you also to read, here we have put the salient features of different phyla of animal kingdom. If you look at the phylum Porifera to Chordata, it has been summarized. First will be level of organization, second will be symmetry, third will be the coelom, segmentation, digestive system, circulatory system, respiratory system, and the distinctive features for each phylum has been put in this tabular column. But before that, I would like to slightly explain to you individually so that it becomes more easy for you. Now let us look into phylum Porifera. These, you know, are commonly referred to as sponges, generally marine and mostly asymmetrical. They have primitive multicellular organisms with the cellular level of organization. Sponges are canal system wherein water moves to ostia from the sides of the body to a cavity in the center called spongocell and through an opening at the top called as the osculum. This pathway of water transport is helpful in food gathering, respiratory exchange and removal of waste. Digestion is intracellular. Body is supported by skeleton made up of spicules or spongin fibers. Organisms are hermaphrodites. Now let us look into phylum Porifera. This is very, very important. They might ask you, they will just give you these three organisms as A, B and C in a jumbled order. They will not give you in the same order as it is found in the textbook. You had to identify this is a cycon, this is a eusporangia and this is a spongilla. Now if you look at Porifera, we have put the key features here. So here the key feature will be body with pores and canals in the walls. Now let us look into the next phylum. That is phylum Coelenterata. They are aquatic, marine, sessile or free living organisms. Sessile means that which is attached to the substrate. They are radially symmetrical. They exhibit tissue level of organization, diploblastic. Digestion is extracellular and intracellular. Some cnidarians are skeleton of calcium carbonate. They exhibit two forms. One is the polyp form and another is the medusa form. See, this is an umbrella shaped structure is called as the medusa form and long tube-like structure is called as the polyp form. Now, some cnidarians will exhibit both the polyp and the medusa alternatively, and this phenomenon is known as metagenesis. So metagenesis means now it is seen in the cnidarians which exhibit both forms by being in a polyp form producing medusa asexually and polyp sexually. So this is the definition. This they can ask you in the exam. The name cnidaria is derived from the cnidoblasts or cnidocytes present in the tentacles. These are the organs of offense and defense and they also help in the anchorage. Two organisms you had to know. It is the Aurelia and Adamsia. So if you look here, now what are the key features of Coelenterata? Cnidoblasts are present. So this is very important. Other example is Hydra. So Hydra is also under Coelenterata. The next one is, sorry, Ctenophora. It is commonly called sea walnuts or comb jellies. They are exclusively marine. So this is very important. They exhibit radial symmetry, diploblastic organisms. Body has 8 rows of ciliated comb plates which help in locomotion. Digestion is both extracellular and intracellular. And bioluminescence is well marked in Ctenophora. So this is a very important point. You might find bioluminescence in insecta, but in invertebrata, if you see, phylum Ctenophora shows bioluminescence. Sexes are not separate, so they are also called hermaphrodites. Reproduction is by sexual means. Fertilization is external and they exhibit indirect development. Indirect development means from a larval stage, the adult stage is got. So this is one example you have. It is called as the pleurobranchia. Now see here, we are given comb plates for locomotion. This is the distinctive feature of Ctenophora. The next one is Platyhelminthes. Flatworms. Platyhelminths are the flatworms, mostly endoparasites found in animals, including human beings. Bilaterally symmetrical, triploblastic, acoelomate with organ level of organization. They have specialized cells called flame cells. This is very important. So they have specialized cells called flame cells which help with osmoregulation and excretion. Sexes are separate. Fertilization is internal. Development is through larval stages. Hooks and suckers are present in parasitic form. Some of them absorb nutrients from the host directly through their body surface. So these are the two platyhelminths. This is a tapeworm. and this is a liver fluke. So this is very important diagram. Now, Annelida, aquatic or terrestrial, free living and sometimes parasites. They exhibit organ system level of organization and bilateral symmetry. They are triploblastic, metamerically segmented and coelomate animals. Metameric segmentation means each body is divided into smaller segments which are similar and repeated. This is known as metameric segmentation. Body surface is distinctly marked with segments and this is known as metameres. They have circular and longitudinal muscles that help in locomotion. Circulatory system is closed. Neural system consists of paired ganglia connected by lateral nerve to a double wall nerve cord. Nereus is dioecious, but earthworm and leeches are monoecious. So this is very important. Please make a note of it. Nereus is dioecious, earthworm and leeches are monoecious. Now here you find out the phylum Annelida. This is the Nereus, this is the earthworm, and this is the leech. They might ask you to identify what is what, which organism is which, or they might give you the structure of Nereus and ask you to identify. This is a tentacle, palp, parapodia. So these are the things you will be able to identify. In earthworm, it will be genital papillae and the anus, they might ask you. Next is phylum Arthropoda. This is the largest phylum, is Arthropoda of the animal kingdom. Now, bilaterally symmetrical, triploblastic and segmented coelomates. They have organ level of organization. Body is covered with chitinous exoskeleton. That means the skeleton is made up of chitin. Body consists of head, thorax and abdomen. Respiratory organs are gills, book lungs or tracheal system. Circulatory system is of open type. So there are no blood vessels. The body has got blood. All the organs will be bathed in the blood like that. Sense organs like antennae, eyes, statocysts or balance organs are present. Excretion is through malphigian tubules, mostly dioecious. Internal fertilization is seen and mostly viviparous. Development may be direct or indirect. Now I am not putting you the pictures of arthropods because you will be able to understand. The next second largest kingdom is molluscans. So they are terrestrial or aquatic, bilaterally symmetrical, triploblastic and coelomate animals. They have organ system level of organization. Body is covered with calcareous shells and is unsegmented with a head, muscular foot and a visceral hump. The space between the hump and the mantle is called the mantle cavity, in which feather-like gills are present. So this word mantle cavity, feather-like gills are very important. Gills have respiratory and excretory functions. See, in mollusca, gills have two functions. One is respiration and also excretion. Make a note of it. Anterior region has sensory tentacles. Mouth contains file-like rasping organ called radula, usually dioecious, oviparous and show indirect development. Phylum Echinodermata, these are got exoskeleton of calcareous ossicles, exclusively marine organisms. They exhibit the organ system level of organization. Adults are radially symmetrical, while larval forms are bilaterally symmetrical. They are triploblastic and coelomate animals. Digestive system is complete. Presence of water vascular system is the most important feature of phylum Echinodermata. What is the function of water vascular system? It helps in locomotion, food capture, food transport and respiration. Excretory system is absent. Sexes are separate. Reproduction is sexual and fertilization is external. Development is indirect with free swimming larva. So this completes your, even phylum Hemichordata is also there. Organisms like worms, which are marine in habitat, they exhibit organ system level of organization. They are bilaterally symmetrical, triploblastic and coelomate. Body is cylindrical with an anterior proboscis, collar and trunk. Circulatory system is of open type. Reproduction is through gills. Excretion is facilitated through proboscis gland. So this is very important. Please make a note. Excretion in Hemichordata is through proboscis gland. Sexes are separate, fertilization is external, development is indirect. Now let us get into phylum Chordata. Now characterized by the presence of notochord, hollow nerve cord and a paired pharyngeal gill slits, bilaterally symmetrical triploblastic coelomates, exhibit organ level of organization, possess post anal tail and a closed circulatory system, Now we have also summarized it because that is sorry. Very important comparison between chordates and non-chordates. So in chordates, notochord is present. In non-chordates, it is notochord is absent. Central nervous system in chordates is dorsal, hollow, and single. Please understand. In non-chordates, it is ventral, solid, and double. Pharynx perforated by gill slits. Gill slits are absent. Heart is ventral. Heart is dorsal if present. A post-anal tail is present. And post-anal tail is absent. Now let us look into classification. So the three division, the three subphylum of chordata are urochordata, cephalochordata, and vertebrata. Now, how the division vertebrata is classified? Let me give you an example. Let me explain. Agnatha, that is they lack jaw, class cyclostomata. Gnathostomata bears just so superclass. Now you should understand fishes come under superclass. So and tetrapoda comes under the superclass. Now Pisces is a superclass, and in that it has two classes, Chondrichthyes and Osteichthyes, the details of which I'm going to explain. Tetrapoda, that is bears four limbs. Example you have classes are amphibia, reptilia, aves, and mammals. So now let me get back to the first thing. Jawless fish, cyclostomata. All members are ectoparasites on some fishes. They have elongated body bearing 6 to 15 pairs of gill slits for respiration. Cyclostomes have a sucking and a circular mouth without jaws. Body is devoid of scales and paired fins. Cranium and vertebral column are cartilaginous. Circulation is of closed type. Cyclostomes are marine but migrate for spawning to fresh water. Now, after spawning, within a few days, they die. So, if you look at an animal like salmon, it comes back, it goes back to its place, and then it dies. After spawning, within a few days, they die because they take a very long route. That is, from they either migrate from ocean to the fresh water or fresh water to the marine water. They travel quite a long distance, and that is why they die after spawning. Their larvae after metamorphosis return to the ocean and they exhibit catadromous migration. Now you have to see in cyclostomata, important thing is they exhibit catadromous migration. The next class you have is Chondrichthyes, that is cartilaginous fish. These are the marine animals with streamlined body. They have cartilaginous endoskeleton. Mouth is located ventrally. Presence of persistent notochord. Gill slits are separate without an operculum. Skin is stuffed with placoid scales. Teeth are modified placoid scales directed backwards. They swim constantly as they lack swim bladder. Heart is two-chambered. Some have electric organ and some poison stings. They are poikilothermic, that is they can't regulate their body temperature. Sexes are separate. Males are claspers in their pelvic fins. They show internal fertilization. Example is your shark. Osteichthyes means includes both marine and freshwater fishes. They have a bony endoskeleton. Mouth is mostly terminal. Four pairs of gills covered by an operculum is present. Skin is covered with cycloid or ctenoid scales. Air bladder is present and regulate buoyancy. Heart is two-chambered. They are poikilotherms. Sexes are separate. Fertilization is external, oviparous organisms, and they show direct development. So this completes your superclass fish and class fish. Now class amphibia can live both on land and water. They had two pairs of limbs. Body is divisible into head and trunk. Some may have a tail. Amphibian skin is moist. Eyes have eyelids. Tympanum represents the ear. Alimentary canal, urinary and reproductive tracts open into a common chamber, and this is called as the cloaca. Respiration is by gills, lungs, and through skin. Heart is chambered with two auricles and one ventricle. They are poikilothermic animals. Sexes are separate. Fertilization is external, oviparous, and development is indirect. Hello. Another 5 minutes, maybe test I will show them on some other day. I have 2-3 more slides to go. So you look at class Reptilia, mostly terrestrial animals. Body is covered by dry and cornified skin, epidermal scales or scutes. Tympanum represents the ear. When limbs are present, they are two in number. Heart is three-chambered, but it is in crocodile. Poikilothermic organisms. Snakes and lizards shed their scales as skin cast. Sexes are separate. Fertilization is internal. Our oviparous ensure direct development. The last two classes, let me just go very briefly. Class Aves, so you know they have feathers. They can be birds with flight and without flight. They have a beak. Forelimbs are modified into wings. Hind limbs are scales and are modified for walking, swimming and clasping. Skin is dry without glands except the oil glands at the base of the tail. Endoskeleton is ossified by fully and the long bones are hollow with air cavities. Digestive tract will have additional chambers, crop and gizzard. Now, heart is completely four-chambered, homeothermic organism. So, class Aves and class Mammalia are homeothermic organisms. The rest three are poikilotherms. Respiration is through lungs. Sexes are separate. Fertilization is internal and development is direct. Now, let us get back to the last class, that is Mammalia, to which you and I belong to. They occur in variety of habitats. Some are adapted to fly or live in water. Presence of mammary glands. That is why it is called class Mammalia. Two pairs of limbs adapted for walking, running, burrowing, for swimming or flying is there. Skin is covered with hair. So the three characteristics, if they ask you, hair covered with skin covered with hair, external presence of external ears or pinna, and presence of mammary glands. These are the characteristic features of the class Mammalia. Heart is four-chambered, respiration is by lungs, organisms are viviparous, and development is direct. So, now I know that it is a little cumbersome for you to understand all these things, but once you read it, when you're reading, keep one organism in your mind and keep on ticking, and the entire thing has been captured in a nutshell for you in this table with the salient features of different phyla of the animal kingdom. And we have also put the examples which they will ask you in the exam. So if you look at Porifera, Cycon, Spongilla, Euspongia, Coelenterata, Physalia, which is also called Portuguese man of war, Adamsia, Penicilla, Gorgonia, Meandrina, Tenophora, Pleurobranchia, Tenoplana, Platyhelminthes, Tenia fasciola, Ascalminthes, Ascaris, Ocularia and Ancyclostoma. Ocularia is the one which causes filariasis. Annelida, Neris, Peritima, Hirudinaria. Hirudinaria is the leech. Orthopods, Apis, Bombox, Lacifer. That is economically important. Anopheles mosquitoes, Culex, Aedes, Anopheles, Culex, Aedes or Vectors. Locusta are gregarious pests. Limulus is a living fossil. So why we have given you these clues? It is easier for you because questions have been asked based on these traits. Now Mollusca, Phyla, Pinctada, Sepia, Loligo, Octopus, Aplysia, Dentalium, etc. Echinodermata, Astraeus, Echinus, Antidan, Cucumeria, Ophiora, Hemichordata, Balanoglossus and Sacoglossus. See, I know it might be a little overwhelming when you are reading this lesson, but I am again repeatedly telling you, please don't go beyond your textbook. All the questions will be asked within your textbook and stick on to your textbook. That is what I would say. Now, before I end this, see, in this select package, if you take anything, like as I said, if you take NEET premium, and then this is subject wise tests are there. If you look at the NEET full test, there are 38 tests in which some 15 are teacher created tests. So we have taken into consideration NCERT based questions, previous year's questions, and also the ones that can change the game changer questions. And we have created a question test that will be useful. And we also have got NEET past papers for 20 years, which will be of great help to you. That is why I'm still suggesting that you go in for this package. And this would really help you to have a thorough revision and thorough practice so that you are able to face NEET exams with confidence. Thank you, children.